Hello, friends, and how is everyone doing? It's a beautiful day here in Chattanooga. So welcome to my virtual Sunday school class. I hope all's well with you. And let's go to the title of our class, okay? The title of our class is Another Pharaoh Opposes Israel. And y'all are in for a wonderful treat. This is a beautiful, beautiful class. Plus, I've got some video clips to show you. I'm all excited about it, okay? All right. So welcome. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to look at the lesson overview, okay? And here is the central truth for our lesson. Discerning and yielding to God's plan helps us to choose wisely. What is the focus of our lesson? Acknowledge and give thanks to God for carrying out His plans for His people in spite of opposition. And then what is the evangelism emphasis? Recognizing God's majesty can lead sinners to repentance. Hallelujah. All right. Next thing we're going to look at is the golden text. And it's coming from Exodus chapter 10 and verse 7. And it's coming from the KJV. Okay. Pharaoh's servants said unto him, How long shall this man be a snare unto us? Talking about Moses. Let the men go, that they may serve the Lord thy God. Knowest thou not yet that Egypt is destroyed? Okay, and with that, we're going to go to our worship song. And y'all can worship along with me. Yeah, this song has been pre-recorded, okay?
When I think about the Lord, how He saved me, how He raised me, how He filled me with the Holy Ghost, how He healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how He picked me up and turned me around, how He placed my feet on solid ground. When I think about the Lord, how He saved me, how He raised me, how He filled me with the Holy Ghost, how He healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how He picked me up and turned me around, how He placed my feet on solid ground. It makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank You, Jesus. Lord, You're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank You, Jesus. Lord, You're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise.
Hallelujah! It makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank You, Jesus. Lord, You're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank You and we praise You, for this is the day that You have made, and we shall rejoice and be exceedingly glad. enter his gates with thanksgiving and enter into his courts with praise. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be exceedingly glad. Thank you for one more day. Thank you that your mercies are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Thank you that you've given us power to step upon all the power of the enemy, to step upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt us. And Father, we praise you, we magnify your name, for you are Jehovah Rohi, the Lord God, our shepherd. We shall not want. You make us to lie down in green pastures. You lead us beside the still waters. You restore our souls. Yea, even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we shall fear no evil, for thou art with us. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort us. You anoint our heads with oil. You prepare a table in the presence of our enemies. A cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. And we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your loving kindness. And Father, I come to you now for my virtual Sunday school class. Lord, I pray for the precious anointing of the Holy Spirit to help me to teach your word, Father, and to make it plain. And Father, I pray that you would guard my mouth and my tongue to say only those things that you want me to say. For I ask it in Jesus' matchless name. Amen and amen. All right. So here's what we're going to do. We are going to look at the scripture overview, okay? And then we'll look at the video clips, okay? So here we go. Here is the scripture overview. Pharaoh's magicians recognize God's hands. And this is coming from Exodus 5, 1 through 2. Chapter 7, 8 through 13, then 19 through 23, and then chapter 8, 1 through 7, and 16 through 19. Point number two, Pharaoh's officials fear Moses' God. Exodus 9, 8 through 20, and then chapter 10, 3 through 7. And then point number three, Israel blunders the Egyptians. Hallelujah. So we're going to watch a brief clip, about a 4 or 5 minute clip, about the plagues, the judgments of God that fell on Pharaoh, okay? And so if you'll give me a second to just set all that stuff up, and we'll be... ready in a minute, okay? All right. Okay, here we go.
Feeder of cattle, carrier of ships.
Berry College stands above for reasons in plain sight. All this in a place of inspiration and opportunity, where we'll help you create a plan.
Praise of all the God, Pharaoh of Egypt.
You have not yet obeyed the Lord. Let my people go.
This is Moses.
Point of a sword shall
let him rave on that men shall know him mad.
Obey the Lord, or he will raise his hand against the waters of the river.
I have come to bless the waters. You have come to curse them. Who will learn if a God of shepherds is stronger than the gods of Pharaoh? Water of life, Give drink to the desert and make green the meadow.
Aaron, stretch out my staff against the waters.
Where he struck the river. He bleeds. The water turns to blood.
Blood flows from the god.
See how it spreads. It is blood.
That you may know the power of the Lord. For 7 days, Egypt will thirst.
7 days without water will
fill every jug and jar.
Pestilence will be everywhere.
For it's 7 times 7 days. No magician's trick will set your people free. Sacred water, make pure the flood from which you came.
And God smote the land with all manner of plagues, but still Pharaoh's heart was hardened.
Great one, you hear the cry of Egypt.
They would cry louder if they had to make the bricks. Send them away.
The people have been plagued by thirst. They've been plagued by frogs. By lice, by flies, by sickness, by boils, they can endure no more.
Back here, home!
Why do you bring this worker of evil before me?
The people desert the temples. They turn from the gods.
What gods? You prophets and priests made the gods that you may prey upon the fears of men. When the Nile ran red, I too was afraid. Until word came of a mountain beyond the cataracts, which spewed red mud and poisoned the water. Was it the staff I gave you that caused all this? Was it the wonder of your God that fish should die and frogs should leave the waters? Was it the miracle that flies and lice should bloat upon their carrion and spread disease in both man and beast? These things were ordered by themselves, not by any God. Now go.
That you may know these things are done of God. You shall see hail fall from a clear sky and burn as fire upon the ground. You shall see darkness cover Egypt when the sun climbs high to noon. And you shall know that God is God and bow down to his will.
Nothing of this earth can make me bow to you, Moses.
Behold, the hail comes. When darkness has covered Egypt for 3 days, your ministers will send for me.
Okay, and I'm gonna play a clip about the final plague where the firstborn of Egypt are killed. Okay, so just hold on for a second. Okay, here we go. The final plague.
Are the captains of Egypt afraid?
Here's to delicious fall favorites. Made with love right at home.
Sorry about that.
Afraid of a night mist?
The death cry is everywhere. Some devil's curse, look! I've known battle for 30 years, Pharaoh. But I've not known fear till tonight.
Aid. Have the captains join their men. With the coming of dawn, we will strike. No firstborn Hebrew shall live.
Let the Hebrews go, great one, for we are all dead men.
Pharaoh's son dies today.
He was your son?
My firstborn.
There is no magic cure, no spell to use.
He is the firstborn of Pharaoh.
We have no skill before this pestilence.
My father.
My son.
Your own curse is on him.
Where did you hear this?
From Moses.
I would not let his people go because your serpent's tongue hardened my heart. You only thought to keep Moses here. You cared nothing for my throne or my son.
I asked Moses for his life.
The shadow of death is on his face.
No. He will not die.
Captain, take my fastest chariot. Bring Moses to me.
I will bring him, mighty Pharaoh.
He's my only son. You have conquered, Moses. The foot of a slave is on the neck of Egypt. You were saved from the Nile to be a curse upon me. Your shadow fell between me and my father, between me and my fame, between me and my queen. Your shadow now fills all things with death. Go out from among us, you and your people. I set you free.
Amen. Amen. Okay. All right. So that brings us to the end of those two clips. And we're now going to go to the introduction of our lesson. Okay. Wasn't that beautiful? And the last clip we saw was about the plague on the firstborn, where all the firstborn of Egypt died, okay? All right. Okay, here's the introduction to our class. And the title of our class is Another Pharaoh Opposes Israel. This lesson presents us with a defining event in the history of Israel, the Exodus. Indeed, from this time forward, the calendar will be based on the Exodus, Exodus 12 and 2. Even today, almost 3,500 years later, the Jewish people look back to this event as their beginning as a nation. Here they became the covenant people of God. God asserted that would happen, chapter 6. He emphatically declared he would deliver Israel from bondage, verses 5 through 6. He would take them to himself as a covenant nation, verse 7. And he would bring them into the land promised to their fathers, verse 8. To accomplish these things, God openly confronted Pharaoh and the false gods of Egypt. He did this through a series of supernatural demonstrations, establishing his power and sovereignty over both nature and humankind. We traditionally call these the 10 plagues of Egypt. However, the scripture does not use the term plague. Instead, it refers to these 10 divine acts as signs and wonders from God. Chapter 7, verse 3. Indeed, as the Bible writers would look back on the Exodus, they would consistently speak of what happened as the miraculous signs of the Lord's power. These acts of God culminated in the Passover and Israel's deliverance from Egypt. And the term Passover means when, Moses was able to pass through the Red Sea. He lifted up his staff and the Red Sea opened up and they were able to cross over on dry land. Now, these acts of God culminated in the Passover and Israel's deliverance from slavery in Egypt. Excuse me. They also remind us of the necessity of obedience to God. They demonstrate that God will accomplish his purpose and plan. Whether we experience his blessing in this or his judgment depends on how we respond to his commands. So let's go to point number one. Pharaoh's magicians recognize God's hands. And a serpent and bloody water, Exodus 5, 1 through 2, and then 7, 8 through 13, and then 19 through 23, okay? So let's do that. Here we go. Pharaoh's magicians recognize God's hand. Afterward, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, "Thus says the Lord God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast to me in the wilderness." And Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, nor will I let Israel go." Wow. Okay. And then let's look at 7, 8 through 13. Then the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, "When Pharaoh speaks to you, saying, 'Show a miracle for yourselves,' then you shall say to Aaron, 'Take your rod and cast it before Pharaoh and let it become a serpent.'" So Moses and Aaron went into Pharaoh. And this is the miracle of this, how when they cast Moses' rod, it becomes a serpent. Of course, that was not covered in the clips, because it would take up too much time. So, and what happened was Pharaoh's magicians did a trick, and there were serpents there too. But what happened ultimately was Moses' serpent ate up all the serpents of Pharaoh. did so, just as the Lord commanded. And Aaron cast down his rod before Pharaoh and before his servants, and it became a serpent. But Pharaoh also called the wise men and the sorcerers. See, I was just talking about that. So the magicians of Egypt, they also did in like manner with their enchantments. Aha. For every man threw down his rod, and they became serpents. But Aaron's rod swallowed up their rods, and Pharaoh's heart grew hard, and he did not heed them as the Lord had said. And then let's go on. We're going to talk about 19 through 23, okay? And this is the bloody water. We saw that in the video clip. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, say to Aaron, take your rod and stretch out your hand over the waters of Egypt, over the streams, over their rivers, over their ponds, and over all their pools of water, that they may become blood. And there shall be blood throughout all the land of Egypt, both in buckets of wood and pitchers of stone. Ah. And Moses and Aaron did so just as the Lord commanded. So he lifted up the rod and struck the waters that were in the river in the sight of Pharaoh and in the sight of his servants. And all the waters that were in the river were turned to blood. Ah, the fish that were in the river died. The river stank, and the Egyptians could not drink the water of the river. So there was blood throughout all the land of Egypt. Verse 22, then the magicians of Egypt did so with their enchantments, and Pharaoh's heart grew hard, and he did not heed them as the Lord had said. Hallelujah. All right. And then verse 23, and Pharaoh turned and went into his house, neither was his heart moved by this. So let's go and read the details of all this and see what that all that is talking about. Okay. Okay. Moses had fled Egypt and lived in exile for 40 years, Acts 7 and 30. Following this period, God sent Moses and his brother Aaron back to Egypt to face Pharaoh. This was a different king than the one who attempted to kill Moses, Exodus 2, 15 and 23. They told Pharaoh that God wanted his people to go into the desert to worship him. Pharaoh's response is striking. Who is the Lord? Your Pharaoh used the Lord's personal name, Yahweh. In effect, he said, who is Yahweh? He has no authority over me. He cannot tell me what to do. I do not know who Yahweh is, and I will not let this people go. Remember, Pharaoh considered himself a god. He rejected the authority of the true God to assert his own authority. Further, he believed the Hebrews were his slaves, thus his property. To demonstrate his sovereignty, Pharaoh ordered the Israelites to harsher labor. They now must make their quota of bricks without being provided any straw to work with. Verses 6 through 8. Everything that follows is essentially Pharaoh and the gods of Egypt confronting the Lord God. Okay. In Exodus 7, God began his demonstration of power. The first sign occurred before Pharaoh and his court. Aaron cast down his staff and it became a serpent. Serpents, especially cobras, were considered sacred in Egypt, a symbol of immortality. Pharaoh showed disdain for this miracle. He called on the magicians of Egypt to duplicate what happened, which they did. But Aaron's rod / serpent swallowed up their serpents. verses 11 through 12. You see that? So God was demonstrating here that his power was greater than all the power of the magicians. There is an important point here. Egypt was famous for its magicians. The Jewish Talmud, a collection of rabbinical teachings, says 10 portions of witchcraft were given to the world. Egypt received 9 and the rest of the world 1. The ability of these magicians was real. This was not seen only in the power to turn rods into serpents, but also in turning water into blood and calling forth frogs. Remember, Satan has real power, but there is a limit to what he can do. After the frogs, the magicians could no longer imitate the works of God. Now began the famous 10 plagues. We may draw parallels between each of the 10 signs and specific Egyptian deities. The Lord wanted to contrast his power with that of these false gods. God told Moses to confront Pharaoh as he went to bathe in the Nile River in the early morning, probably an act of worship. The Nile was seen as divine. Hapi, H-A-P-I, Hapi, was the god of the Nile. Excuse me. And Isis was the Nile's goddess. With Egypt being a desert land with little arable soil, the people looked to the Nile as the source of life itself. So when Aaron used his staff to smite the river, which immediately turned to blood, the Lord demonstrated he is the true God and Lord over the Nile River. But Pharaoh only became stubborn and hard in his heart. All right, what copycat acts did Egyptian magicians perform? How do false religions today try to mimic acts of God? It's a very good question, okay? The magicians, for example, threw their rods and they became snakes and so on and so forth, okay? But those were all false because ultimately Moses' rod swallowed up their rod. So how do false religions today try to mimic acts of God? They do similar things, okay? But those so-called miracles are actually fake, okay? Satan has power, but his power is limited, and God's power is far greater. And the scriptures clearly says we have power over all the forces of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt us. And then we go to the frogs and the lice. That was the next plague, and so on and so forth, okay? All right. God is not an actor within the larger scheme of things. He's not a muscle-bound Jupiter bullying the little ones. He's the author of the whole thing. And now point number two, Pharaoh's officials fear Moses' God. And then boils and hail. And we saw that clip, okay? Here we're going to go to frogs and lice. And the Lord spoke to Moses, "Go to Pharaoh and say to him, 'Thus says the Lord, let my people go, that they may serve me. But if you refuse to let them go, behold, I will smite all your territory with frogs. So the river shall bring forth frogs abundantly, which shall go up and come into your houses, into your bedroom and on your bed, into the houses of your servants, on your people, into your ovens and to your kneading bowls. The frogs shall come up on you, on your people, and on all your servants.'" Aha! You see that? So this was the plague of frogs. Okay. So let's quickly look at that. Okay, here we go. We typically think of the confrontations with Pharaoh as being times of judgment. They were actually expressions of God's mercy. Time and again, the Lord offered Pharaoh a chance to change, but he repeatedly refused. Now, God sent Moses to Pharaoh again, giving him another chance to repent of his rebellion. Once again, he refused. A second time, Aaron looked to the Nile, and God sent frogs on the land from it. Can you imagine how disgusting this must have been? Even their beds and kitchens were full of frogs. The women couldn't eat bread without having to push frogs aside. Again, God confronted a specific Egyptian deity. Heket was a frog-headed deity. The goddess of fertility, childbirth, and resurrection, what the Egyptians worshipped as life-giving, was now odious to them, was repulsive to them. In response to Pharaoh's continued disobedience, God sent a third sign, but this time without any warning. Aaron struck the earth, and from the dusty sands of the desert, lice, or perhaps gnats, filled the air. The frogs had filled the houses of the Egyptians, but the bugs attacked the people's bodies. Another Egyptian false god was opposed here. Geb was one of the primordial gods of the Egyptians, the god of the earth. Yet he was powerless to bring relief to the people in their misery. Seeing this mighty God impotent before the Lord of Hebrews caused the magicians to declare, "This is the finger of God." Verse 19. In the Bible, the phrase, "the finger of God," indicates the presence of God at work. Amen? All right, let's go on. Next thing we talk about is Pharaoh's officials fear Moses' God, bows and hail. Okay, and we're kind of running out of time, so I might just read through some of these scriptures. Frogs and lice. All right, here we go, bows and hails. So the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "Take for yourself handfuls of ashes from a furnace and let Moses scatter it towards the heavens in the sight of Pharaoh, and it will become fine dust in all the land of Egypt, and it will cause boils that break out in sores on man and beast throughout all the land of Egypt." Aha. Okay. Then they took ashes from the furnace and stood before Pharaoh, and Moses scattered them towards heaven, and they caused boils that break out in sores on man and beast. And the magicians could not stand before Moses because of the boils, for the boils were on the magicians and all the Egyptians. Aha! But the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, and he did not heed them, just as the Lord had spoken to Moses. God had warned Moses that, you know, even after all these plagues and pestilences, Moses is going to harden his heart. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say to him, 'Thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me. For at this time I will send all my plagues to your very heart and on your servants and on your people, that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. Now if I had stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, then you would have been cut off the earth." And we're kind of running out of time, so I'm going to go on to with the next scriptures, okay? "But indeed, for this purpose, I've raised you up that I may show my power in you and that my name may be declared in all the earth." So God was using Pharaoh against the Jewish people because God wanted to show off his power against the most powerful leader on the face of this earth at that time, the Pharaoh of Egypt. As yet, you exalt yourself against my people, in that you will not let them go. Behold, tomorrow about this time, I will cause very heavy hail to rain down, such as not been. And we've seen that in the clip, in the video clip, right? How it rained hail, and when the hail fell and touched the earth, they turned into balls of fire. Behold, tomorrow about this time, I will cause very heavy hail to rain down, such as not been in Egypt since its founding until now. Therefore, send now and gather your livestock, all that you have in the field, for the hail shall come down on every man and every animal which is found in the field and is not brought home. They shall die. Okay. He who feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his livestock flee to the houses. Okay. All right. Next is the plague of locusts, okay? So Moses and Aaron came into Pharaoh and said to him, "Thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, how long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? Let my people go, that they may serve me. Or else if you refuse to let my people go, behold, tomorrow I will bring locusts into your territory." So this was yet another plague, okay? A pestilence. "And they shall cover the face of the earth so that no one will be able to see the earth. And they shall eat the residue of what is left which remains to you from the hail. They shall eat every tree which grows up for you out of the field. They shall fill your houses, the houses of your servants and the houses of all the Egyptians, which neither your fathers nor your father's fathers have seen since the day that they were on this earth on this day." And he turned and went out from Pharaoh. Then Pharaoh's servants said to him, "How long shall this man be a snare to us?" They were telling Moses, "Let the men go, that they may serve the Lord their God. Do you not yet know that Egypt is destroyed?" So they were trying to convince Pharaoh. Pharaoh's own advisors were advising him to let Moses go and his people go. Now, Israel plunders the Egyptians one more plague. And the Lord said to Moses, "I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt. Afterward, he will let you go from here. When he lets you go, he will surely drive you out of here. Speak now in the hearing of the people, and let every man ask from his neighbor and every woman from her neighbor articles of silver and articles of gold." So did you see that when they left, when the Egyptians left, they left laden with silver and gold that the Egyptians themselves gave them so that they just leave them alone and get out of their land. Okay? So they didn't leave Egypt empty-handed. They left with silver and gold and all kinds of good stuff. The Lord gave the people favor in the sight of Egyptians. Moreover, the man Moses was very great in the land of Egypt, in the sight of Pharaoh's servants and in the sight of the people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it came to pass at midnight, now immediate departure, and it came to pass at midnight. This was the when the Lord struck the firstborn of Egypt, and we saw that video clip. And it came to pass at midnight that the Lord struck all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh, sat on his throne, to the firstborn of the captives who was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of livestock. So Pharaoh rose in the night, he, all his servants, all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt. for there was not a house where there was not one dead. Then he called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, Rise, go out from among my people, both of you and the children of Israel, and go serve the Lord as you have said. Also take your flocks and your herds as you have said, and be gone and bless me also. Aha. See, so finally, Pharaoh is willing to let them go. And the Egyptians urged the people that they might send them out of the land in haste. For they said, we shall all be dead. So the people took their dough before it was leavened, having the kneading bowls bound up in their clothes on their shoulders. Now the children of Israel had done according to the word of Moses, and they'd asked from the Egyptians articles of silver, articles of gold, and clothing. Amen? So Moses had told the Jewish people, make sure before you leave, you ask the Egyptians for silver and gold and clothing so that we don't have to leave here without anything. We'll have to leave here with silver and gold and all kinds of provisions. And the Lord had given the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians so that they granted them what they requested. Thus they plundered the Egyptians. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay. And I think we've run out of time. That brings us really to the end of our class. I'm sorry I had to rush through the final scriptures, but because we watched those video clips, that took up some of our time, but those video clips were awesome, weren't they? And if you've never watched the Ten Commandments, I suggest that you go on YouTube and watch the entire movie. It's a pretty long movie, if I remember right, okay? And that brings us to the end of our class, okay? And we're going to finish with the worship song that we were singing.
When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground. It makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise.
And by the way, some of those scriptures that I kind of went through real quickly, if you go to my website, percyparak.com, I will put up all the scriptures and you can get the PDF of the entire lesson, okay? So you don't miss anything, okay? Thank you for listening. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. Shalom. Nothing missing, nothing broken. Hallelujah. May the Lord bless you exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think according to his power that works within us. In Jesus' matchless name, amen and amen. Thank you for listening. And if you like the broadcast, please put likes on it. And please share it with your friends so more people can get to hear it, okay? And Please, in your comment section, mention the city and country from where you're listening, okay? I'd really appreciate that. Nobody's doing that, but if you can remember to do that, I'd really appreciate it. Thank you for listening, and may God bless you in Jesus' matchless name.